I am the Great Saiyan Man, and I'm gonna beat some fashion sense into you!
Aw, man. Hope my disguise is working. This is Gohan from Dragon Ball Z. You're listening to This Week in Geek with Mike the Birdman Dodd and the rest of the Twig Crew right here on ThisWeekInGeek.net.
Did you grow up with the NES, PlayStation, Star Wars, cartoons, and 80s TV? Do you like to think who would win in a fight between Batman and the Master Chief? Comics, games, movies, music, and TV, they're gonna tell you everything you need. Superheroes or not, they got your back. They're gonna save the world of geeks. Comics, games, movies, music, and TV, they're gonna tell you everything you need. Superheroes or not, they got your back. They're gonna save the world of geeks.
Hello, hello. It's time for another quick Turner Treasure episode where we gather the few reviews we couldn't get into the main show in the last week or so. There's only a couple this one, a few for me, a couple games, and a couple from Michael. I believe he has a Tony Hawk impression on the demo that was out, as well as a new Vita title. I have Is It Wrong to Pick Up Girls in a Dungeon? The game based on the anime / manga, and I also have Kanagawa Jet Girls, and I have PGA Tour 2K21. So we've got five reviews for you here, and I'll come back at the end and sort of give an update on what's going on, because interesting and exciting things. At least for me, for this weekend. Without further ado, here's the first review. I'm here with just a very quick review of P-Cube's Is It Wrong to Pick Up Girls in a Dungeon, which is obviously a tie-in game for the anime and manga, or is it a light novel? I can't remember. One of the two. I've watched the anime and thought, okay, it's in that standard style of a lot of the fantasy, you know, almost like gamified animes that have come out recently. And the basic story is you go into a dungeon to become more powerful so you can impress people. Pretty standard fare for the young boy or teenager anime out there. And the gameplay, it's interesting. It mixes some of the almost like anime cutscenes / visuals of the anime, and then it goes into almost like PlayStation 1 era little 3D sprite dungeon crawler, and there's missions that are time-based, you know, go into the dungeon, get to a certain point by a certain time, or collect a certain amount of treasure to take out and level up with afterwards. Pretty arbitrary mission structure, but overall pretty fun dungeon crawling. Controls work well, audio is fine. It's nothing to write home about as far as the visuals are concerned. It is just a fun pick-up-and-go game. I think it's not going to impress everybody. If you're a fan of the show or the manga, it's great. If you're somebody new to it completely, it is probably best to have watched or read the story firsthand. It is not going to be like the hardest or most impressive display of a dungeon crawler out there. But for somebody like myself who doesn't care for a lot of dungeon crawlers, this almost brought me back to a nostalgic PS1 Super Nintendo era style of gameplay. And I enjoyed that quite much. It was a pretty good impression left upon me. If it's on sale, pick it up. I don't think it's something that is going to wow, you know, a newcomer unless they know the series. So maybe check out a few episodes of the anime first. If you like that, you're probably going to dig the game.
Basically, he's a geek.
Leave me alone, geek boy.
Holy shit, you geeks are badass.
I
Look, Tony Hawk, how do you do an ollie? Why can't you skateboard when you're 40? Well, I'm 49. The end.
Discovered several eyewitness accounts of skateboarding at some of history's greatest crimes.
That's obviously doctored.
This is Tony doing what appears to be an ollie off the balcony moments after Lincoln was shot.
This is insane.
And this is Tony grinding down the tail of a dinosaur moments before the meteor hit that exterminated all dinosaur life on the planet Earth.
Wow, that one's kind of true.
Hey guys, it's Mike the Birdman here, and I'm here to talk to you about the demo that I got sent for Tony Hawk Pro Skater 1 and 2 from Activision. This game does come out as a full retail release next week. There is a collector's edition, which does come with the skateboard, but I'll probably be playing this digital, because what's a one-legged guy going to do with a skateboard? Although, I'm just saying, it would be kind of cool, but point of the matter is, let's get talking about this demo. So, I've been a huge fan of the Tony Hawk franchise for a number of years. My first Tony Hawk game was Tony Hawk Pro Skater 3, and I played the hell out of that on my PlayStation 2, and I played the series all throughout college, and even played Tony Hawk Ride, where I almost fell through the floor of one of my houses. Trust me, it's a long story. But anyway, so this game, playing through it, this feels great. This is the warehouse demo, which everybody knows if you've been a fan of the Tony Hawk franchise for any number of time. But playing through this, everything feels so familiar. If you've been playing the series for a long time, your skills will take a little bit to adjust, but not long at all. Playing through this, the physics feel different, like I said, for just a few minutes, but eventually my skills started to come back. It feels different not playing this on a PlayStation 2 controller or an Xbox controller. So once I kind of got my feet under me, or my proverbial feet, it started to feel good, especially because you see a lot of quality of life improvements, especially because the team has learned over this game's vast history what works, what doesn't, stuff like that. And while I haven't been able to master all my combos like I used to, like pulling off million point combos was not that hard for me way back in the day, I'm still learning how to hit my reverts, I'm still learning how to hit all my lip tricks and getting all my grabs so I'm able to grab my board so I don't hit, you know, the pavement as soon as I hit the floor there. But it feels good. I like how this demo feels, especially if this is any indication of the final game. I mean, this series has a lot to live up to, considering the last Tony Hawk game wasn't so well received, and there are several YouTube documentaries that go into it. But this feels fantastic. I really think the series is in fantastic hands. In the demo, they do show off some of the soundtrack as well. You get Goldfinger Superman, which is the iconic song. You get Rage Against the Machine, Guerrilla Radio. And this surprised the hell out of me. Billy Talent, Afraid of Heights. And they're a Canadian band, one of my favorites, actually. So that was really, really cool. There's another artist who I can't remember. Honestly, I turned that song off. I just didn't much care for it. But one thing I really did like was this neat quality of life improvement where you just hit R3 and the song just skips. You don't have to go into a menu. You don't have to adjust anything if you don't want to. It just works. So that was a neat quality of life. One of the things I didn't like, though, is when you bail, the song, it doesn't stop, but it turns down in volume and you get this weird VHS rewindy sound. And it just kind of screws up your flow. However, there are game assists where you can turn off some of those options if you want, which I think used to only be available via cheat code, but whatever, because I never played with cheat codes when it came to this other than like secret characters. And I think recently they said Jack Black's going to be Officer Dick in this, so cool. But yeah, like, I really, really, really like this. The Tony Hawk series has always been the gold standard for me in terms of extreme sports titles. And it doesn't do anything goofy. Like, you can't do the caveman and run off the board. It doesn't try and reinvent the wheel. No, this is pure skateboarding. And it feels good. It feels like I remember with modern gaming taken into effect with it as well. I mean, I really can't express how excited I am to play as Tony Hawk, Eric Costin, Bob Burnquist, Rodney Mullen, one of my favorite skaters of all time. Just watching him do all those insane manuals. Chad Muska, Alyssa Steamer. The only character I really wish was in this, but he didn't come in until Tony Hawk 3, was Bam Margera. But whatever. There is a digital collector's edition as well, which you can get some extra creative skater stuff, which I'm really hoping that I get that. Because like I said, what's a one-legged guy going to do with a skateboard? But still, no, this is something you should probably keep on your radar. If you were a fan of the Tony Hawk games early on in the last pretty much 20 years, then keep an eye on this. I really think you are not going to be disappointed. And even if you are new to the series, if you want something that's more, it feels authentic, but not as, it feels different than EA's Skate franchise did, in my opinion. Skate never really took off with me, but Tony Hawk Pro Skater absolutely does. So Tony Hawk Pro Skater 1 and 2 is something to keep an eye on. You should pick this up when it comes out at full retail next week.
XSEED sent over Kandagawa Jet Girls, which is from the same development team that does the Senran Kagura series, so you sort of know what you're in for with the anime fan service style game. But what this is it's a jet racing game, jet ski racing, similar to your wave races, your jet moto sort of thing. And that's what intrigued me the most, because it's been quite some time since we had a good one in that genre that felt right, that's come out. So in playing it, it takes just a little over a dozen hours or so to complete. It has pretty concise controls. There are some of the jet skis are a little more difficult to control, but that's, you know, standard for these kind of games. And then you work your way up to getting better ones. There's cutscenes between each level. There's not a whole lot to the actual gameplay loop or story. It's race amongst a handful of the same tracks, sort of over and over and over again, with little bits of storyline happening afterwards. It's overly easy from what I found. I've struggled very little with the game, which, you know, depending on how you're looking at it, can be good. If you're looking for something to play for like an hour or so before you go to bed, or just something on the go that you can have sort of an easy time but still have some fun turning and firing weapons and so on at your other contestants, it can be cool. The only problem is, if you race pretty decent, you'll be so far ahead of everybody else in the race that you won't really get a chance to use the weapons that much until you get to some of the more difficult races at the end of each sort of campaign, which is like the last couple or so. When that happens, then you know you're more just trying to catch up, because you're left with harder turns that you can barely get, or the AI gets pumped up a little bit, which is good. Now, when you're playing in the non-campaign mode, you can crank up the difficulty and give yourself a real challenge, which is good there. That provided a much more significant challenge. As far as audio and visuals are concerned, the audio is pretty much standard for what you can expect from these kind of anime games. Decent. The visuals are pretty good. I didn't encounter any stuttering or any frame rate issues or anything. There's no latency from like the time you press a button to something happen on screen. The controls are pretty tight. It's a very well-coded game. It's very well-optimized. I enjoyed my time with it. I don't think it's going to be for absolutely everybody. And if you're in somebody who wants like a highly competitive game that with very, very difficult modes, you're not going to find that here. What you are going to find is just a pretty fun, arcadey anime style racing game that is a bit better than a lot of the competition that's out there. But don't expect it to be, you know, the second coming of like a wave race.
Those magnificent bastards!
Color me kooky, but something very odd is going on around here.
You're not allowed to talk anymore.
What day is it? The date!
12th May. Thursday.
What year?
Hey guys, it's Mike the Birdman here, and I'm here with yet another video game review for you, except this time I'm taking a look at a, let me look at my notes here, a PlayStation Vita game? This is 2020, right? Yeah, I know, weird. Somehow this has happened, somehow this is still 2020 and we haven't been killed by murder hornets or asteroids, but hey, the year's not over yet. But no, I'm actually looking at a piece of good news. This latest digital release comes to us from InN Games. I'm looking at Ultra Core. This is a title you may have heard. It was released on the Switch. There was a physical release across several different platforms, including a Sega Genesis cart. So what this is, allow me to take you back to the mystical year of 1994. I'm still in grade school. I'm still watching Fox's X-Men on television, and I'm still playing video games. Things are looking rather cool. I had no idea this game existed. So this game was actually developed by Digital Illusions, who you now know as DICE. That's right, the Battlefield and Star Wars Battlefront developers. And this game was canceled as the next generation of consoles was coming around. So this game was randomly found on like an old hard drive, I think is the story that I've read. And it has been restored so you can play it in the year 2020. What is this game? Well, it's kind of like a hybrid of, like, if Contra and Metroidvania had a baby, though not really. It's not as in-depth as a Metroidvania, and it's not as simplistic as Contra. It's kind of this weird hybrid. People have had it described as kind of a European-style shooter, and I can't disagree with that. Basically, you run around, it's a run and gun, you do have a health meter, so it's no one-hit deaths. You do get weapons that like you can upgrade and everything. You fight mini-bosses. And I'd love to tell you more about this game, but it kicked my ass! This game is hard, but not so hard that you don't have fun. There is passwords for this. Presumably there are cheats for them. I couldn't figure any of them out. Even searches on Reddit, I couldn't find a whole hell of a lot. But what I did find here was a rather enjoyable game that's going to take a lot of practice to get good at. You do get, I think, 5 lives per continue to explore the various stages in the game. There are mini-boss fights. They're not particularly hard, at least the ones that I encountered, but they will challenge you. And it's not hard to lose lives going down pits, as I did find out. One thing I did find tremendously cool is there's a lot of different sound options here. There is the original FM chip sound, which is fine. That's what the Sega Genesis cart would have sounded like. But there's a CD version of the sound. And this reminds me a lot of the music from the Terminator, which I think was Tommy Tallarico, if I'm not mistaken. And the soundtrack to this game is friggin' amazing. You're hearing it under this review right now. And I was like, wow, this is incredible. And it makes you want to keep playing, as you want to keep hearing more and more of the soundtrack. I was genuinely surprised by how in-depth the gameplay got, because you do have to collect key cards, you have to find hidden switches to open doors, and there's a lot of backtracking and back and forth for you to get through stages there. So it's not just as simple as run from left to right and kill everything in sight. It does ask a little bit more of you. Like I said, Ultra Core is hard, but if you're a better gamer than I, then you can probably get a good chunk of enjoyment out of this. The fact that it's available on so many different platforms is, I think, astounding. Just the fact that I'm playing my Vita in 2020 is kind of amazing. I mean, games that were once locked to the Vita are now being released on like other platforms. In the case of Persona 4 Golden, now we have a game that was exclusive to other consoles and other digital platforms is now coming out on the Vita. Man, 2020 is weird, but do I think you should check out Ultra Core? You know what? Check out some gameplay online, see what you think of what you see, but from my personal opinion, it's hard, it's challenging. If you're willing to stick with it and willing to learn its mechanics and how fast you react, I think you're going to find a pretty rewarding kind of hybrid shooter here. I was genuinely surprised. If anything, I think it's worth picking up for the soundtrack. So pick up Ultra Core on the Vita, of all places, from NN Games.
This is a fair request, and I promise I will not judge any person only as a teenager, and that this is no more right than saying all teenagers are drunken dope addicts or glue sniffers.
I'm here with another game quickie review. I have PGA Tour 2K21 on Stadia. I was provided a code from 2K to check it out. I have not played a golf game dedicated probably in 10, 15 years. Because I know that the PGA Tour series had its ups and downs and has sort of come back with a vengeance this year. A lot of people were anticipating it, and it is available on Stadia. So that was the copy that was offered to me. And I went, hey, you know, let's check it out. Golf, again, not a super fast-paced game. Should perform quite well on the platform. And it did. I'll tell you sort of interestingly, to set it up, you do sign up with an account. So you put in your name, your demographic information. You agree to it. Sign up on first play. It loads a profile and generates some stuff for you that takes... It took me about a minute or so, even on using their cloud service, I guess, to sort of go to the 2K backend and connect you. But after that first initial setup, every time I load the game, it's like 2 seconds and I'm in. I'm going to assume that's significantly faster than playing it locally, simply because it's using that cloud service technology to do that. Once that's done, you can play it with mouse keyboard setup or with the controller. If you're playing... with the mouse and keyboard, you get sort of a weird control scheme where you roll back on the mouse and roll forward, and you can then that's how you sort of do your swing. It is easier in my mind to use the gamepad controller. I did encounter some issues initially setting it up and getting it to pair where it kept thinking I was on mouse and keyboard. But after getting through the pairing, and I had to do an update to the controller, once that was done, I was good to go, and it worked just perfectly fine, played buttery smooth. The graphics are an update from what I've seen of past games. Load times, like I said, are nil once you've done your initial setup and the first time you load up the game. As far as audio is concerned, it's a golf game. You know what you're in for. Visually, it doesn't encounter any... hiccups or issues being on the streaming platform. It is one that does work better playing it in 1080p versus 720. So if you're trying to save bandwidth, you know, you can do it in 720p mode, but it does look better in 1080p, or I'm assuming if you're doing it in 4K. But let's be honest, with Stadia, the 4K and 1080p are minuscule changes at best. It all depends on your actual connection speed. So most people will be playing at 1080p. Very enjoyable. I can see myself playing a lot more of it. I don't think this is going to be a game you're playing on your phone through Stadia, because of, even though, you know, you'll have the finger controls, the accuracy of it and being able to see it on the screen, it's something you would probably end up doing if it's available on your tablet, if that's an option. But right now it's mostly phones and computers and the Chromecast Ultra that play it. But you know, it is the kind of game that you need to be a little more accurate with, and on a smaller screen it might be more difficult. It is an enjoyable golf game. It's got all the mechanics down pat. I can see myself playing this on and off throughout the year. So you know, if you're a golfing fan and you want to take something that you can play on many platforms and just sort of log in on the go, it's worth picking up. If you are on the fence, because, this is coming out on standard game consoles, like current edition game consoles as it is, and you're worried about maybe future-proofing it because you're going to maybe be getting a PS5 or an Xbox One, Xbox Series X, getting it on Stadia, at least you know it's future-proof in that it's going to play on any device that you want to play it on. So In that sense, it's worth picking up. If you're not a fan of golf, you're not going to like it. So I would say pick it up if you like golf games, or if you're like me, you're a lapsed fan that wanted to come back. And it plays well in Stadia, which is becoming more and more the standard thing I'm saying, because they've worked out a lot of the kinks, and I think the experience is sort of getting to where it needs to be.
Do you have any hobbies?
I collect spores, molds, and fungus.
Hold that thought. It's crapper time.
All right, and that's going to do it for this week's show. I wanted to make sure I recorded it early. There might have been a couple more reviews we could have put in there, but I am going to be visiting my family this weekend. My grandmother had a fall and had a bit of a health scare, but she seems to be okay, but I wanted to check in on her, so I'm visiting her, and it ties into... interestingly enough, the return of the movie theater, at least in my area in Ontario. They've been open now a couple weeks, and I wanted to make sure I waited. Oh, it's been probably 5 weeks that they've been open. I wanted to make sure that there hadn't been any rise in COVID cases or any issues or hiccups involved there. And so far, everything's been clear. We've had one new case, I think, in 2 weeks or 3 weeks in my city. And it coincided with everything getting ready to go to theaters. The first movie that's in theaters was, I think it was a week ago, Unhinged went into theaters, which we got a preview edition of to watch as a screener. It was fairly restrictive, which, you know, it was still enjoyable, which says a lot for the film. But I'm not going to go see that in theaters. But I did get some free tickets to go see a couple things at a few different theaters. Now, one, there's a third film that may or may not happen, but... Friday, which is when we're dropping this episode, I may be seeing the Bill and Ted Face the Music, the third Bill and Ted movie, at a local cinema. And again, depends on how full it is. They're limiting, I think, to 20 people in a theater that holds like 350. Timing wise, we'll see how that works. If not, I am definitely seeing Tenet at IMAX. I am, as far I can keep checking on the app to see who's bought tickets. I'm the only person that's bought a ticket for that showing. And by bought a ticket, I mean I had a comp ticket completely covered. So I'll be seeing that on Saturday. And later on Saturday, I had a comp ticket covered to go check out The New Mutants at another theater. So I'll be checking out the three main theaters, I guess, in my town. And I had been hesitant about even attempting it until I saw the numbers. Like, this is not like the States, where things are not contained, and other parts of Canada, things aren't contained. But the numbers seemed right for me to accept the tickets, where I'm like, okay, one new case in the better part of several weeks. No issues with the theaters here because of their precautions and measures. Plus, I have the ability to cancel my tickets at no cost to me, even up to an hour before the showing, if I'm like, yeah, I get spooked, it's too many people showing up, or nope. If it's still going to remain like dead empty like that, I'm willing to go and I'll give my report as to see, you know, not only how are the movies, but I'll make sure I talk about what the experience is like going to theaters for those areas where it is safe to open and do that. So we'll see how that goes. Again, this could all be called off last minute, but that is what the weekend is looking like for me. Then I'll be back and recording with Birdman. We're going to actually attempt to record in person together with our microphones and his new podcasting audio interface setup. And we'll see how the quality goes there. It won't be every time we record together, but sometimes we might be able to. It's going to help if we decide to do commentaries again. The only reason we haven't done commentaries has been it's difficult to sync up and do that remotely. And his previous setup wasn't really conducive to that. It will be now, with individual volume controls for each person and so on, without being complicated. So, as far as what else is coming up on this week's show, review-wise, on the main show, I have Spiritfarer for the Stadia. It's also available on Switch already. Birdman has a couple reviews, I believe. I think he has a Scooby-Doo one of some sorts. And he has something else in the works. I can't remember what it is. And this coming week, we will be doing another loose canon B-movie review discussion special with Aaron Pollier on The Immortalizer, We also have a Future Imperfect in the works to talk about all of the pilot episodes of the various TV series that in the Star Trek universe. We've also got some, I think there's one or two episodes syndicated that we're going to have out that Birdman's on the Nerd to the Third Power podcast. And we are recording, I believe, either this, depending on who edits it, either this weekend or next weekend, we will have a new episode of Twig Sunday Funnies, our roughly monthly comic book topic discussion show, where we are talking about the team-ups in comics or in teams that are maybe not the mainstream. I'm not very schooled in this. I'm literally picking one at random and being like, I'm going to read up a little bit about that. We're going to talk about it. The other guys are much more into it. And then I'll be taking a bit of a hiatus. I won't be on every episode of Twig Sunday Funnies because I have a lot more on the go. I'll still help with editing and I'll pop in for specials here and there, but it might be every other show or something like that, because basically everything else that we do at Twig, I got my hands in, and I'm like, I can't be a part of every single thing. You guys take the reins, and I'm not as versed in comics, so I'll come in when there's a big topic, like when we do a Halloween special and certain things, I'll come in, but I won't necessarily be on every episode, and this will be the last one I'm on for at least a month or so. We'll see what happens. But it's going to be fun, and it's also going to be, we're going to try to keep the episodes to just under an hour or so in length, unless there's something major to talk about. And we've got some stuff in the works with Andrew Roebuck. I believe Birdman is going to be discussing aliens with him. I think the Alien franchise. And I guess in several weeks, we'll be starting ramping up our Halloween programming. And I will be on with them to discuss the Nightmare on Elm Street films. Some of them, I think, Dream Warriors for sure, and maybe something else the three of us will be discussing. So there's going to be some fun stuff in the works. And we're going to see how things go in the next couple weeks when it comes to next-gen video game stuff, because we're ramping up. It sounds like there's going to be announcements as to when we can pre-order things and press release information goes. So we'll probably, as a big announcement or something happens, we'll have some coverage this week or this coming week. We'll do a prototype episode on Gamescom and probably touch upon the crappy Nintendo Direct that just happened. So that is sort of your update on what's going on the site. Lots going on, and I guess I'll talk to you guys later.
Well, that's our show.
All right, here's the deal. Every time you watch my show, I will send you $40.
Checks will not be honored.
You've been listening to This Week in Geek, your source for guaranteed nonsense or your money back. Tune in next week for more info and the most important things you didn't need to know. Check out our website at thisweekingeek.net and subscribe to our podcast through iTunes or any podcatcher. If you'd like to comment on this episode, head over to this episode's post at thisweekingeek.net and leave a comment through Facebook Connect. Follow us on Twitter at thisweekingeek.net and follow our Instagram at twig_official_podcast. Social media not your thing? Send us an email at feedback@thisweekingeek.net. We'll see you next time, and remember,
lower your shields and surrender your listenership.
Just when you think this show is terrible, something wonderful happens.
What?
It ends.
I have to go. Somewhere there is a crime happening.